Cause I don't care when I'm with my baby, yeah. All the bad things disappear. But you're making me feel like maybe I am somebody. I can deal with the bad nights when I'm with my baby, yeah. Ooh, 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 ooh. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Cause I don't care as long as you just hold me near. You can take me anywhere. But you're making me feel like I'm loved by somebody. But it's like you're the only one here. I don't like nobody but you, baby. I don't care. I don't like nobody but you. I hate everyone here. I don't like nobody but you, baby. Yeah. Cause I don't care, don't care when I'm with my baby. Yeah. Oh, yeah. All the bad things disappear. Disappear. You're making me feel like maybe I am somebody. Baby, I'm somebody.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Hello, everyone. Welcome, alumni and guests, to a conversation with Dr. Charles. Excuse me. Let me do that again. Welcome, alumni and guests, to a conversation with Kerwin Charles. My name is Courtney Lightfoot. I'm Managing Director of Alumni Relations here at Yale SOM. For those of you just joining us today, I just want to welcome you back to New Haven officially. We're really happy to have you here, and I hope you've all had a wonderful day of catching up with one another. We are thrilled to see so many alumni back on campus for the first time in 3 years. if you can believe it. And we're excited as a school to start getting you connected to one another again in person, in events here in New Haven and all over the world. So we're really looking forward to seeing a lot more of you. So I'd like to take a moment to recognize and thank what I think is over 100 class secretaries and reunion giving and planning committee members who have been supporting my team and over the past several months to help us create a really fun and meaningful experience for you this weekend. So I know there are many of you in the room, so I'd like to ask you to please stand if you're able so that we can give you a round of applause. I want to make the most of our time, so without further ado, it is now my great pleasure to introduce Dean Kerwin Charles. Kerwin joined ELSOM in 2019 as the Indra K. Nooyi Dean and Frederick D. Wolf Professor of Economics, Policy, and Management. Previously, he was the Edwin A. and Betty L. Bergman Distinguished Service Professor at the University of Chicago. He has studied and published on a range of topics, including earnings and wealth inequality, conspicuous consumption, race and gender labor market discrimination, health and the labor market, the effects of housing booms and busts, and non-employment in the economy. Among other professional duties, he recently served as the vice president of the American Economics Association and is on the board of several academic and nonprofit entities. He is also a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research and an elected fellow of the Society of Labor Economics. So please give a warm welcome to Dean Kerwin Charles.
Thanks, Courtney. Hi, everybody. It's absolutely wonderful to see you. I can imagine that being on campus, being back again, is a profoundly emotional experience for you all. It's wonderful for us to be able to welcome you here. For the last 2 years, two plus years, this is my third year as dean, remarkably. For nearly two-thirds of that time or more, we have not been able to assemble in person. Gatherings like this were ruled out by the pandemic. And so whereas I've met many of you by Zoom, telephone, and the like, I've not seen you in person. I've not seen you, for sure, aggregated as you are. So welcome. It's a light. It's wonderful to have you. Yale has this reunion tradition. People come back every 5 years or so. Shortly after I arrived here, I realized how important a practice and a tradition this is. It's built into the bone and sinew of the institution. As I reflect on what makes reunion special, whatever the institution we're talking about, it occurs to me that part of what makes them special is to come face to face with what's different. Yes? One sees one's dear friend from many years ago, 25 years ago, 10, 40 years ago. Yeah? And things have changed. There's a little bit more gray. There's a little bit less hair, kind of thing like that. Yeah? And so we revel in that, in observing how different we are relative to when you met them many, many years ago. As you come back to campus, as you come back to SOM, it is not only that the big hair from the 1980s is lower, yeah, or that the weird sweaters that I see in some of those photographs have gone out of style, but there are differences in your school. You will notice I say your school. Because when I think about an academic institution, its permanent custodians, the persons to whom it is linked forever, are not the faculty. The faculty come and go. Yes? I hire somebody from Princeton, she stays here for 10 years, she goes to Berkeley. Yeah? Certainly not the deans. Deans come and go. In the long life of a school, the tenure of any dean represents just a tiny fraction of the school's history. The only individuals for whom SOM is a lifetime identity, yeah, is you. It's alums. As it were, SOM is stamped on you forever in a way it's not true for me, or the staff, or the faculty. As you come back to your school, you will observe some differences. There are many differences. Let me tell you a couple. One is the sheer scale of the place. When I became dean, Peter, the president, shared with me a photograph of a classroom gathering of the first class at the school. Maybe it was the second class. It was one of the early classes. And Bill Donaldson is sitting in a kind of semicircle with, I don't know, 12 people, some small number of people. Could have been 20. No, let's not quibble about the number. The point is, I was just struck by the intimacy. The fact that from those early classes, everyone would have known everybody else. Do you see? When you come back to a school, had you come to our graduation ceremony of a month plus ago, you would have observed that we graduated hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of students. The entering class this year will be 320 or some number like that. One big difference, therefore, is the difference of scale. It's a vaster place than when you were here. Had you sat through the ceremony, you would have observed or heard that I mentioned graduates in systemic risk. What is that? Yeah? EMBA. You vaguely know what that is. Yeah? MBA, I would have said. Yeah? All these different degrees. We have 5 degrees at the school. Our school is different in terms of the breadth of its offerings. The very first class here came and took a degree in the Masters of Advanced Management. I mess it up all the time. It's MPPM, Public and Private Management. Yeah. We had the 1 degree. Now we have 5. Lots of changes. The school is way more international than when you were here. Yes? Way more international. We draw students from all over the world. Some of our degree programs, the Global Business and Society, are structured around bringing to Yale and bringing to SOM an entirely international population. Yeah? So you look at the place, you come back, it's not just the hairdos and the things. The school itself feels different. Feels different. But reunions tend to be emotional and powerful because in the difference, that despite the changes, one can see consistent threads. Not everything has changed. One thing that's not changed is the passion of the students. I must tell you that their grades and test scores are better than yours. I got it. I'm just being honest with you. Yeah. The students are better every year. So that's just the way it is. Yeah. But like you, they felt deeply moved to come to this place for a special reason. We'll talk about it. What has not changed is the commitment of the faculty. Faculty members feel very deeply about this school. And in deciding whether to come or whether to be retained, they don't only weigh purely pecuniary considerations. Some university offered X more than theirs, so I should stay or go. No. They say we're doing a special thing here. And it was only reluctantly that they give up that special thing. The staff are similarly impassioned and connected to the school, just like when you were here. So there's some similarities. The most fundamental similarity of all, the thread that runs through classes and over time, every class, is the mission. The mission. We say at this school that we are devoted to training leaders for business and society. We say it endlessly. We say it proudly. We mean it. I hope we mean it. Come back to that momentarily. Something which we appeal all the time. When people are welcomed here at their orientation, when they leave at convocation, at multiple touch points throughout their 2 years or 2+ years, depending on the student, we talk always about this mission. When the school was established, it was established with the belief that leadership, competent leadership, would require the mastery of a certain set of skills, which skills could be deployed across spheres and contexts. Yeah? There were management skills that we were imparting, which would be useful in business, useful in nonprofits, useful in... Yeah? That remains true. This notion of ours, that business and society, as we said, the ampersand that's above my shoulder here, is a distinctive and unifying thing of the school at the dawn. Yeah? That remains true today. It is distinctive. It's distinctive. This year, I participated in a review of the Kellogg School of Business and of universities in London. There is a practice whereby deans of some business schools, three or four, review every, we say, in the same equivalence class, business school around. It happens every 7 years. The way the calendar shook out is that we had a review this year here at Yale, and we were reviewed by the Stanford Business School Dean, the Northwestern Business School Dean, and the Haas Business School Dean. And we opened the books to them, they saw the budget, they heard a class, you open up the thing. I happened this year, coincidentally, to be reviewing other places, as I just mentioned. What was striking about the report which we received about a month ago about Yale was how salient they thought the mission was in all we did. How distinctive they thought it was. Yeah? That made me incredibly happy. And it should make you happy. I'm convinced that the mission that animated the founders of this school has never been more relevant, has never been more important, irrespective of one's sphere of endeavor. Those among you who have careers in business know that you simply cannot be an important business leader, a productive and durably influential one, unless you're attentive to certain societal concerns. Yeah? You know that your employees care about fairness in evaluation, that your customers care about how the environment, the community in which your business sits. Are you attentive to it? Are you caring for it, thus and so? Yeah? While doing well, are you doing good? Yeah? That's true in your business, whatever your business is. I don't care what it is. Those of you who are engaged in work in what's called society, whether it's nonprofits or in politics or whatever, know that society is beset with a set of challenges, the resolution of which necessitate business insights and cooperation. Name a problem. Pick your favorite problem. Addiction. Yeah? Global warming. We're not going to solve the climate change problem without figuring out how production will be shifted towards more efficient production methods. Yeah? Or devising ways to do carbon exchange. Yeah? Business is always going to be part and parcel of all that we do on the societal end. Our mission has never been more relevant. And we should take a certain pride in that. We should be animated by that. And you should be reassured by that. Yeah? I came back after 30 years, 25 years. What's going on at my school? Yeah. I've told you some things are different. I've told you the main things that are similar. I'm saying to you that the thing that unites all of us, that animates us, and that governs my activity, all of them, constantly are engaged in conversation with the mission. Here are some questions of the sort I ask my leadership team all the time. Question number one. We have to be careful that our mission doesn't descend into mere sloganeering. Do you see? What do you do there at the school over there, Kerwin? What happens at your school? Someone asks you. Oh, we do business and society. What is that? Yeah? What is that? It must not be a mere slogan. If it's a living, breathing, distinctive thing, evidence of it should be seen in all we do. It should be in our curriculum, for example. Yes? For example. If a student comes here wisely, rather than making the hugely unwise choice to go up the street to the place in Cambridge, yeah, she should see in the course of her scholastic training different material, or at least different emphasis on material. And if after 2 years here she asks her friend who went to Harvard, what cases did you study? And they're exactly the same case. Yeah? We must raise a quizzical eyebrow about that. You see what I'm saying? You see what I mean? If there's a business school that takes seriously the important question of how the society is to help lower division by race and ethnicity and national origin, that kind of thing. Every business school should be thinking about that. We have a special imperative to think about it here. Do you see? And so we want to ensure, one, that our mission is vibrant, relative, and authentic in all we do. All we do. Every year, there will be things I emphasize, or the faculty want to do, or the students push for. What I want to assure you, just by giving some examples, of this centrality of the mission in my thinking and what we do, I want to pick three different bins to speak about them briefly. One bin has to do with pedagogy, what we teach. What are our degree programs? What are they like? Here's one example. Our school launched a center, a program, for the training of systems level leaders in public education. It's called the Broad Center at Yale School of Management. We bring to the school superintendents and aspiring superintendents and provide them over a series or a year and a half, depending on their program. We have different ways of structuring the program depending on the thing being pursued. Leadership skills. Anyone who's interested in helping to address the country's challenges of earnings inequality, for example. If I were to raise that as a question, how many people here care about this? You don't have to raise your hand. It'll be more than half of you. Yeah? And then you say, well, how are we going to do that? How are we going to do that? As a labor economist, I can assure you that the preeminent driver of earnings inequality in the United States is a difference in earnings that attaches to differences in human capital attainment. And in particular, I would tell you, that the people at the bottom of the country's earnings distribution have not received the benefit of the education that you have. Those people are disproportionately African American or Latino, or you see? And so any institution that claims to be interested in inequality and its resolution can find no more profitable use of its efforts than to do something that provides leadership to the people who train those kids. We're doing it here. Wharton's not doing it. That's an SOM mission-centered thing. You might say, Kerwin, God, I'm a finance guy. This thing with training teachers, I get it, but we're a business school. I'll talk about that in a second. Yes, we can do it in finance too. Business and society, we say. We have to be excellent at both things. We have to be excellent at both things the SOM way. I've given you an example that could not be further from finance. The training of systems level leaders in public education. Yeah? Our school launched this year, at the same time, a program in asset management. Yeah? It's the asset management program is the brainchild of David Swensen and one of the top finance scholars in the country, my friend Toby Moskowitz. It is the most selective program in the school. And we'll be training students to go out into the world and manage endowments the way that David Swensen did. Attentive to the considerations that he elevated. Kind of like that. That's not training public teachers now. You know what I'm saying? That's training finance people. We're training finance people in a way that would not necessarily be a focus at Wharton. Do you see? We're going to do different things. They're consistent with our mission and our values. We'll do old things, finance, emphasizing different points here and there. Do you see? A third example. As I came here, I looked around at this town, which I didn't know. I don't know New Haven. I lived in Chicago for many years. What's this town? I show up, I want to learn it. COVID. Yeah. That presented a challenge to get to know the plan. I was fortunate in that somewhere around my second year, Yale was doing negotiations for what's called a pilot. And the pilot means Yale's payment in lieu of taxes to its host city. Yeah? Yale existed before America existed. And so Yale has special, complicated tax relationships with it. Yeah? But we support New Haven. Yale makes the largest voluntary contribution to its host city of any major university. But Peter asked me to serve on that committee as its decanal representative. And so over the course of a year, I got to talk to the mayor. By the way, an SOMer, yeah? Talk to me, people, yeah? Over the year, I had conversations routinely with the governor. You could say it now, SOMer, you see? And I talked to them about what we're doing and how Yale can be better and the problems that the city is confronting, thus and so, yeah? And I came to my community here and said, hey, I have people here who claim, our students and our faculty, to want to improve society. Wonderful. What about the society right here? Yeah? I asked the mayor and his team about things they're doing, and they say to me, I asked them during this negotiation, by the way, this number that you're showing me, how does it compare to comparable numbers in similarly sized cities? I said. And the guy said, what are you talking about? You mean like, I said, no, you have to probably go collect data and, you know, do the thing like that. And he said, what are you talking about, Kerwin? We barely got people to put the budget together, okay? We don't have people for all that, he said. And I thought, they don't have people for all that. We have a building full of people who can do that. Yeah? I have many students who claim to want to contribute research efforts, energy, to solving this kind of problem. So you'll be proud to know, I hope, that our school for the next several years, is it in perpetuity, Joe?
No.
Not in perpetuity, but for a long time. With help, I could be an interpreter. So I went to some of you. I went to some alums and said, let's be the only business school that has a formal connection, a supporting connection, with its resident city. Yeah? And one of your number, an alum, gave us some support. And so every year, at least two people from this school, yeah? Before they go on to change the world on Wall Street, yeah? Or in Idaho, whatever they're going back to do, they're going to help New Haven, yeah? Good. As part of that conversation, during that negotiation, it struck me that law schools are a peculiar animal in the following sense. They're peculiar in many ways. Let me focus on one way. Law school instruction goes in two bins, yeah? One bin, torts and criminal procedure and whatever. Contract, I don't know, that stuff. And then there's what's called clinical training. Yeah? The Innocence Project, for example, you would have heard about, is a clinical class where the law school faculty member brings to her classroom the community, yeah, and instructs the community in some important, the resolution or mastery of some important legal issue. Yeah? How do you clear something off of your record? How do you, whatever like that. And I thought, why can't we have that here, man? There are people in this town who want to open up a small business. Work with me, people. There's a woman in this town who has an idea for a hair braiding shop. Yeah? She needs to figure out how to rent a business, rent a place to do the thing. She needs to figure out how to advertise. You see what I mean? She's got to figure out how to write a business plan. She's got, yeah? We could do that. We can be the first business school that does that, do you see? So I said to Peter, we should do this at Yale. And he said, that's a great idea. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to create a center. It's called the Center for Inclusive Growth. And unfortunately, I have to run it for the next couple of years. Yeah? But I'm giving you a sense that of how we're trying to push the mission forward in myriad ways. Do you see? We're about to launch a campaign. And we've launched it already. One has to emphasize particular areas. And my objective in crafting or thinking about the areas for which we'll be seeking support is to ensure that the thing we're asking for is tied to the mission in important ways. I'll give you three examples. Shut up. Take questions. One set of things has to do with the students. Business school education, in my view, my humble view, has gotten too expensive and continues to become more prohibitively expensive every year. I know what some of you are saying. People come to business school, after all. I'm sure they can do the present value calculation. Yes, of course, I hear you. Yeah? But the sticker price worries me. The sticker price worries me. And even if what you just said is true, that can't they do the present value calculation, blah, blah, blah. Yeah? Our competitors are being ever more generous than we can be. And you might say, Kerwin, Harvard's been around 1 million years. Yeah? Of course they might have bigger fine. We're running behind places like Virginia. You hear what I'm saying to you? We're running behind places like Virginia. We have to increase the generosity of our scholarships. It's an existential issue for us. Unlike other places, our students will go off, many of them, to careers that will not be highly remunerative. And that's fine, yeah? That's fine. But we don't want such a student to be dissuaded from thinking about coming here in the first instance. Yeah? It is also the case that there are particular classes of students for whom more generous support matters unbelievably. Historically underrepresented groups. This matters a lot. When we admit an African-American woman, an Hispanic man from Texas, I get on the phone and talk to people. You got to come to Yale. You crazy not to come to Yale? Come on, and thing like that. Yep. I'm reasonably persuasive person, I think. And we're chatting. Oh, why, what's the holdup? Well, you give me a half scholarship. Yeah. Virginia's giving me a three-quarter scholarship. Columbia is giving me a three-quarter scholarship. It doesn't matter what I say at that point. Yeah. And so in order to be competitive and to preserve the position we have painstakingly gained, we've got to make our scholarships more general. Students. What about the faculty? There are many things related to the faculty that we have to support generously going forward. When many of you came to school, our program was characterized by the very small student, what do you call it? Student teacher, you know, number of kids, what do you call it? Student pupil, thank you. Student teacher ratio is what I'm saying. Yeah? 11.3, these numbers. Remember that photograph I told you about? Yeah? Of the first dean and like eight people around him, like, I looked at our class size over the last few years. Our class size is growing. It's not exponential growth, but it's concerning growth. Yeah? The intimacy that characterizes this experience, and therefore the things that flowed from that intimacy, the chance to ask the professor a question, follow up, that's fading. There is the issue of the composition of groups. Ours is not a school that can say, while maintaining this mission, we're going to focus on finance. Only. We can't do that. That's not our school. You see? And so I say to you, there are groups like, say, my OB group. You remember your OB classes? That's kind of what makes our school, yeah? And there are groups that of that type, my OB is an example, for which I need support. We've got to buttress that group. There are groups that over the years have shrunk dramatically to zero. Let me give you one example. When first contacted about this job, it said something business and society, something like that. I'm reading up and think, and I show up and I say to someone, by the way, where's the political economy group, political science group? I say, innocently, because I don't know. And they say, we used to have one back in the day. Way before I even heard, way long ago. We don't have one now. Yeah? I'm not here making a statement that says we should definitely have one. Yeah? But it seems to me, that all of the business you are doing or contemplating doing, yeah, has to occur in a societal context with rules and parameters set by the political establishment, political actors, and so on like that. Why can't we rebuild such a group? You see what I mean? And let's have a grand ambition. Let's not rebuild a group, you know, please, let's rebuild a great group. This leads me into my other point, excellence. I am convinced that the most important thing that academic institutions provide and produce is new scholarly knowledge. I believe that, irrespective of field. Yeah? We have to have a world-class faculty. A world-class faculty. What do I mean by that? I mean that when I hear that the place up in Palo Alto or the place in the south side of Chicago is going after someone in marketing, yeah? And I say to my marketing group, well, why do we go after her? Let's go after her too. You see? Let's just have an OB group. Let's try to have the best one in the world, is what I'm saying to you. We might not get there, but we certainly won't if we don't try. Our faculty is not sufficiently diverse by race, ethnicity, and gender. I come to senior faculty meetings, I look around, and there's less than a handful of women. Tenured people. There virtually no, there's one or two black faculty on our, you know what I mean? Virtually no Hispanic faculty. You see? We gotta do better than all that. I'm convinced we can do all these things because the time has never been better for us. This is our moment. In fact, if I'm worried about one thing, it's not that our time is off. I'm not worried about that. I'm worried about people stealing our thunder. I'm worried about people belatedly claiming that they care about society too. You see what I mean? Someone sent me a brochure recently. I won't name the school. Yeah? I won't name the school. Let me just say it's sort of in the northeast area. And it's produced people who rise to the highest rung in the executive branch. Yeah? Good. Yeah. And it says something about, you know, something business, thing like that. And we also care about society too, something like that. And I thought, you see, people can steal our thunder by just stitching the thing on at the end. Yeah? We've been thinking about this for half a century. Half a century. We cannot now know others come in and snatch it out from around us. And so we're doubling down on our mission. Yes? To revivify it. To burnish it. To lean into it with confidence. Yes? Because this is our moment. There's stuff to do. There are challenges aplenty. Undoubtedly, you will ask me about them. One thing I've learned about our alumni base is you have no anxiety about sending the dean questions, comments, thoughts, criticism. It's all good. I've heard from lots of you and God. So, fire away. But this is our moment. Before I turn to questions, I think I want to take a moment to speak about another big change in our community. So many of you would have been taught by or inspired by our beloved late colleague, Sharon Oster. Sharon is someone whom I knew before I came here. Sharon's daughter, Emily, is my very good friend from Chicago, and it is through her that I met her mother. Before I came here, I had an offer to come here 8 years ago or so as a professor. And I stayed at Chicago. I was happy to stay at Chicago. But I came during the visit, and Sharon was my host, you know. Sharon had a party for me and my wife and made all of her drinks, you know. She knew all kind of cocktails. And she's going to make, I think we'll be serving some of the cocktails. Osterini. The Osterini cocktail, yeah. I became dean, and that friendship and support continued. I could call Shannon at any time, jot her an email. She would say, watch out for this one, or do, you know. She was fantastic. And we were deeply saddened by her loss. And I believe that if we push together in the spirit I've just described, we can achieve for the school all that Sharon would have wanted. Yeah? So I didn't want to end on an overly somber note, but Sharon's absence from this community is felt keenly by me, by the staff, by the faculty, and I know by many of you here. So I wanted to explicitly acknowledge that before turning to your question. Don't hold back. Joel, are there
we have microphones,
okay.
So if people raise their hand, somebody will bring the microphone.
Thank you, Dean. Augie Del Rio, class of 2012. Thank you for such powerful words. You know, one thing I wanted to ask you is, what are we doing in terms of fostering more entrepreneurship and unlocking the power of network effects within our community? Myself and actually Bernie, we co-founded a company, and I was just thinking, well, I don't have a single angel investor from SOM. I don't have a mentor from SOM. Shame on me, but how can we actually create a network where, you know, I can talk to folks from class of 82, 87, whatever year, and get perspectives and learnings that they have from their own personal experiences? Thank you, Dean.
Thank you so much. I think it's a great question. I'm not going to fall back on, oh God, COVID has been so terrible. COVID has been terrible, yeah? But one of the things I've been talking to the community about consistently over the last 2 years is entrepreneurship. It matters hugely to our students. It matters to our external supporters. We have, as many of you know, an entrepreneurship center run by my colleague Kyle Jensen. Over the next couple of years, my plan is to strengthen the activity within that center. But you touch on something that really resonates with me. This is finding a way to take advantage of the incredibly close ties among you, the alumni community. I don't know that we have a formalized structure. I don't want to step on Kyle's toes. Kyle's fantastic. So this is not a criticism. But here's what I hear you saying to me. I hear you saying to me, someone graduates in 2022. She has an idea about, I don't know, food, some food thing, yeah? And we have, across the alumni community, from the class of 2012 and 98 and 1992, people who work in that area. Do we have a mechanism for connecting this recent graduate? Yeah? I don't know that we do. This very point came up about a week ago in Mexico. I visited Mexico to meet our alums there, and someone mentioned a version of this point. I don't have an answer for you yet, but I can tell you that you point to something that will be an area of focus for us. Yeah? Let me give you a related thing. So we have at the school a number of joint degrees. More joint degrees exist at our school than at any school of business or management in the country. We have a joint degree with the School of Architecture. Yeah? Joint degree with the law school. Joint degree with the School of Environment. Good. And so I show up, and shortly into my deanship, I become friends with the dean of the School of Engineering. We're doing a Zoom. We used to do Zoom coffee chat. We don't have a joint degree there. We will soon. Don't go spread it yet. Seriously, don't go spread the thing yet. Peter and I have to sign off, and we got to work out who pays what. We're going to do it, yeah? So we're going to have a joint degree in engineering, yeah? And this is going to, so I want you to have in mind here, some whippersnapper engineer doing whatever, circuitry, whatever, thing like that. They want to learn entrepreneurship, yeah? They want to learn about business. So they'll be interacting with our students, and the deal will allow my students to go do some stuff over there, yeah? And so part of what we're working out is like, what's a required class? We're like 90% home, yeah? 90%? You'll hear about it, I'm confident, by December. And that, too, is related to this entrepreneurship point mentioned. I hope you see how. Yeah. Because when we talk to the people in engineering, this is what they mention. I want to be an entrepreneur, but I don't know anything about business. Yeah. So it'll be a focus of ours going forward. Thanks for the question.
Sorry. Thank you, Dean. Very inspiring comments. And actually, my question leads or builds on the previous question. Irina Filipova, class of 2002. I receive letters asking for financial contribution to SOM with frightening frequency. I don't believe I have ever been asked to make any other form of contribution. And yet, I've mentored Yale students, MBA students, I've interviewed for admission. I like to think of myself as an advocate of the school in every way. And in these 20 years, I would think that my experience, the experience of all of us here, can serve the school in so many ways. Why are we thinking of just one way of contributing by writing a check? Thank you.
Yep. So we're not thinking about your writing a check to the school being the unique way you can contribute to it. Certainly not under my deanship. Yeah? And I believe more generally, long before I came here, there was the view that people contribute in myriad ways. Yeah? I believe that, and we're going to lean into that here going forward. Don't mishear me. Everybody, to the extent you can, please give money to the Alumni Fund. Let me be absolutely clear about that. Okay? If you can, give the best you can, support the Alumni Fund. We need it for everything. The computer screens I got to do, okay? So let me establish that. But any of you who've heard me speak to an alumni community before, and one or two of you may have, would have heard me say that the permanent custodians of the school, which is to say you, yeah, can support your school in many ways. Checks are important, people, yeah? But I point to other examples. Here's one example. We're a different kind of school. There's certain kinds of students can come here and flourish. Yeah? There are other students who shouldn't come here. Maybe they should go to these other places. What's our problem? Our problem is I don't know where these students are. You live lives out in the world. Yeah? You meet some friend's kid at a golf course. Yeah? You're doing something at your church. Yeah? You're in a women's group somewhere, and you see a kid, and you say, you know that they belong here. Send them here. You see? That's hugely important to us. Many of you come back and contribute in the classroom. When I ask the students, what class did you especially like? They say, fine, they like the core. They love the core. Yeah? You know what they really love? They especially love when one of you comes back and sits in on a lecture and tells them something. They love that. Find time to do that. Don't tell me you can't do it. Ridiculous. You can find time to come give a lecture here. Yes, you can. That's huge contribution too. Here's another example. I was on a call with an alum, and he said to me, Kerwin, this is early in my deanship. He said, Kerwin, what's going on with ESG? I will admit my ignorance. I said, well, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know. He said, ESG, you know the thing. And I said, honestly, I don't know. Not sure what that is. And he said it's a really important thing. So then I get off the phone and I start reading all about ESG and I talk to the students and they all know and it's important to them. And I go to visit the London School of Economics and the London Business School and Kellogg and they all thought, yeah? And so I come back to my faculty and I say, we don't have a thing in ESG. We don't have an ESG field, yeah? But all the students are talking about it. I heard about it from an alum. There are ideas emergent in the world that come to me late. Yeah? You make a huge contribution to the school. Huge. If you can let me know about that early. Yeah? I can go on in similar fashion. In thinking about the campaign launch, which occurred about this semester, I said multiple times in that launch that of course we care about resources. Yeah, I got a Matt Sumlin scholarship offer at Columbia. Let's not kid ourselves. I got to do it. Yeah, I got to hire a top faculty member. I got to do it. So I care about resources, material resources. But I emphasize that I care a lot about engagement. I care about engagement. And Joel and his team, who work very hard on the engagement piece, have the best development and alumni relations team in the business. Best. They've said, look, we're going to double down on increasing engagement. That's what I mean. And you say to me, somebody sends me a check for X dollars, yeah? Or instead, exhibits her commitment to the school in various ways, like the ones you've listed, yeah? Hugely helpful to the school. Here's one other example. COVID happens. And they tell me, the university tells me, oh, Kerwin, there's a danger that one half of your international students won't come. And I have to create for the president and provost an emergency plan. Because if that happens, I got all kinds of problems on the tuition side. And so Joel and his team, working with me, reach out to alums resident abroad. You see? China. Or some of our Indian alums. Wherever. Brazil. And they talk to admitted students. You see? The student nervous about coming to the U.S. And they all, not all of them, but we had very little slippage. They came. And the success of that recruitment, in my view, could be linked directly to the participation of alums. Now you say, the alum who called five students didn't send a check. Fair enough. You know what it means to me to have five students come when I'm worried about, yeah? You can help in multiple ways. Multiple ways. What is not excusable is not engaging. I'm not with that. I don't want to hear, I couldn't send money and therefore I didn't. Come on with that. You can come teach a class. Yeah? Host an admissions event in your town. You live in Philly? Yeah? Take some kids out to the thing, lunch or coffee, whatever like that. Hugely helpful. Everyone hear me? Joe is going to say something.
In and our alumni receive about twice as many non-fundraising emails or as fundraising, and about 1,500 alumni volunteer each and every year. And in our very purposefully call our report to our alumni impact, the impact people can have on the school, and every single volunteer.
Yes.
But every volunteer, whether it's admissions or career development or teaching in a classroom or being on a reunion committee, you have more than 100 volunteers here.
Thank you. Mark Gilletti from 92. Okay, so I think the school is, what, 14 years old when I graduated, and now it's, what, 40 years old, something like that, right? 45 years old. I think the engagement question and also the networking question that you asked earlier among us, right, I think is important, because when you talk about mission and you spoke about institution to start, institutional knowledge is very difficult among alumni because by definition in a business school we leave every 2 years. We come, we're gone, right? So institutional knowledge and the mission isn't sticking with us as easily because we're off in the world and we're not here. Right. So I think that engagement thing will solve a lot of the financial problems, right, that you're talking about. But if we are in the community and we find somebody who may belong at the School of Management, how do we make that determination? Right. If you're chasing a marketing professor, how do you make that determination that that particular professor meets the criteria of the mission that you want to perpetuate? If you're just going after that particular professor because Chicago's going after them, so on and so forth, you get my point, right? I don't have to go on, right? So we need more about the mission. What does it mean? How do I talk about the mission to somebody? Why is that student, you know, that person a prospective student? So on and so forth. And that's the engagement part, I think.
Fair enough. I don't mean to be misunderstood. The example of, you know, let's go after someone in Chicago or Stanford, go after, presumes that they have cleared the relevant threshold for us as regards mission. So that is there. And so there will be some person studying finance in an ESG perspective, whatever the thing is. I want to go after that person. There's going to be, over the next several years, a series of scholars who will be the best scholar in marketing and economics and finance studying sustainability. Yeah? That's exactly our mission. Yeah? I'm saying I want to go get the best one of them. Good? So there is that sifting. Yeah? Before we... You make another very important point here, though, about how we ensure, given the short time that people spend here, yeah, given the short time that people spend here, how we ensure the sustenance of this mission and the idea. I'm very optimistic there. I jumped on a call with the class of one of the early classes, I can't remember which class. And I'm on the call and I join, you know, I'm trying to hook up the thing, the Zoom thing and so on. And they're on the call. And I'm listening to them as I try to think, I don't get my camera on, and they're talking to each other. And they're talking to each other, but like family, you know? They're saying, you know, I'm not eavesdropping, but they're saying, oh, something, what happened to the other one? Did he move and thing the baby? You see what I mean? They're like family. Yeah? That's something you guys have. Now, we can help you push it along. We'll get ideas from you about how to grow that sense of connection. But I'm optimistic that we can. And we will rely, I believe, very heavily on your participation, your willingness to engage you. But the kind of initial condition is very good for strengthening the kind of thing that we've pointed to. We're not perfect on this. I hear you. Yeah? People here 2 years, traditions could be forgotten. I get it. But the more engaged you are, all of you, the more you guarantee the traditions that you deem important survive and thrive at the school. Yet another reason for you to be engaged.
Okay? Hi, Amy Bevilacqua from Class of 97. Really appreciate your vision for the school and your ambitions for the school. So thanks for that. I was really interested in your takeaways from the peer review report about the mission being integrated throughout the school. Can you share more from that report, more that reinforces the strength of our competitive position and maybe reinforces some of your priorities for growth that will be resourced, we hope, through the campaign?
So thanks. The report was very... The report was very complimentary of the school and of the recent, both remote and recent past and where we're going. They were concerned to the extent that any cautionary note was raised. One, I didn't tell them this. They said, you know, as I remember, one of the people is a Stanford dean. And so they said, as I look at your tuition support relative to some other competitor, yeah. You will have, they're saying to me and to Peter and Scott, you will have to increase this to be competitive. I knew that already. Yeah? Another thing they pointed to, and I have a bad habit of answering questions when put to me, even if they raise complicated reflections. One of the things they said in the report was, the school has to really think always about how the growth in its degree programs, yeah, threatens this profound sense of mission that defines the school. That's in the report. They're not saying we shouldn't do the degree programs yet. Yeah? They are saying that given who you are, given the fact that you are this incredibly connected group united by a mission that's distinctive and so on, you must always be wondering, they say to me and to the leaders of the university, how the addition of an extra program, the expansion of some program, whether it changes and how it changes this sense of connection. There were some things they were wrong about a little bit, you know. What are you going to do? They said, we would, you know, I see that they have very good connections to the university. It would be nice if they were some more strengthened. We are more connected to the rest of the university than any school, yeah? And I just told you about the engineering thing that you're not about to repeat until December. So you just take that with a grain of salt. But those were the cautionary notes. This point I'm about to make was not a criticism, it was just an observation. I'll share it with you. We use relatively few long-term adjuncts compared to other schools. Okay? So if you go to Kellogg, or you go to Columbia, or you go to Harvard, the size of the non-tenure track faculty is huge. Yeah? At school, you guys were taught by tenure track faculty. We have one-off professors, you know, somebody visiting teacher class. But that's something you have to think about. Would it be useful for us to expand the size of our non-tenure track faculty members in ongoing long-term relationships? I have to tell you that the students really love when we bring in, they love their professors. Not love. They really like, you know, they're very happy with their classes. You know, their account, their economic, whatever like that, yeah? But they love when they're teaching some class about the economics of real estate, yeah? And then one of you comes in and talks about their experience in real estate, kind of like, you see? So my challenge as dean is to get that balance right. Yeah? Here's a thing a dean would be very foolish to say. Dear faculty, I've got to tell you, the students are very unhappy with the, no, that's not good. You see? I've got students love everything. Just one little point, though. You see? So I'm trying to work on that. That's a point they raised. It wasn't a criticism. You might say to me, Kerwin, I think we shouldn't double down on adjuncts. You might say to me. You might say, you know, our thing of being very adjunct light is part of SOM. And you might convince me of that. I'm very open to conversation. But that's another point they mentioned. Yeah. Yeah. One last thing. They were great pains to emphasize how closely connected the leadership of the school was to the university. Like, that was noted explicitly in the report. I did three reviews, I just said. And at no review was it imagined that the president of Northwestern would come meet me. Yeah? At Yale, I said to Peter, look, Peter, the people are coming. And he said, you want me for breakfast or dinner or both? You understand? We have a very close relationship. And he was at the kickoff breakfast. Yeah? And so you want me to call people for, do you see? And they made note of that in a report. So, yeah.
Hi, I'm Laura Walker, a class of 1987 and proud parent of a graduate of the class of 2022.
Wow.
Joint degree. SOM obviously means so much to me and to my family, and thank you so much, Kerwin, for your incredibly inspiring remarks, and really, in particular, your focus on the mission. And I just want to ask a question. We are living in a time in our society where democracy is fraying, where our rights are being taken away, where there are deep concerns, I think, about the future of our country and about our world. What is SOM's role in this? What is SOM's responsibility as we look at what is happening in our world? And what kind of education do leaders of society need? And how is that being discussed, debated, and determined here at SOM?
A great question. This is yet another reason why it's in my mind, it's not shaped up yet, I haven't got everything. Why, for example, building out a group in political economy, political science, someone who does political ethics, that kind of thing would be helpful. Yeah? That's an aspiration of mine, something I hope to achieve over the next few years. But your question brings something slightly different to mind, if I may. And this is less about the topical area or group than it is about the nature of scholarly engagement. Yes? The joint learning enterprise, how pedagogy proceeds. I am firmly of the view that truth emerges from the collision, respectful collision, of ideas freely expressed. If your daughter graduated in 22, or son, he would have heard me say that the diversity that ought to matter most to university is diversity of ideas. Most. We're not a tire company, or a cheese company, or a company that sells derivatives or something. We traffic in ideas, yeah? And you have a view about the capital gains tax, yes? Or some new thing in accounting, yeah? And he over there has a different view. And over the course of your 2 years here, I want the environment to be one in which Your articulation of your view is something that occurs freely, unfettered, but respectfully. If you ask me what's the biggest challenge universities confront, I'm not talking about SOM now. I'm worried about this. I'm worried about this a lot. Where there is deliberate and rational self-restraint on the expression of my point of view. Here's the worst thing in a class. Someone gets up to say something. What about this thing? What would be the effect of trade? I'm making things up here. What would be the effect of trade on wages of, you know, native women? I'm making things up. And someone says and feels, well, I think that would be good for native women. Yeah. Restricting trade or restricting immigration would be good. Another person disagrees. It is my suspicion, more than a suspicion, that students are taking the temperature of the room, of the faculty, of the university. Yeah? And to the extent they speak, they are speaking only certain things. How are we doing? That's a terrible thing, I believe. And as long as I'm dean, it could be a year, I don't know how long it'll be, you know, it could be many years. I'm never going to stop beating this drum. At our school, I want us to engage in open, respectful debate and discussion. You will notice how often I have injected respectful. In the articulation of my point of view, the framing of it, the pitching of it in a way that is belittling to the listener is not helpful. Yeah? It's a vigorous, open, respectful engagement or collision of ideas that matter. I think the more of this we do, the better our leaders and the leaders we send out to the world could help address the divisions you point out. I feel this way very strongly. Very strongly. And, you know, sometimes I get a little bit ahead of the community on this, or that I belabor the point a little bit too much, but I'm fine with that. I'm happy for the question. I think Joel and them are nodding and be saying, shut up, Kerwin. That's the double nod. It's been wonderful to talk to you guys. Thanks so much for coming back. We're delighted to have you here. I hope we get a chance to run into you, and if we stay in touch by email, text, Zoom, etc. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dean Charles, for sharing all of the exciting developments happening at SOM. I want to thank all of you, the SOM alumni community, for the many ways that you support the school, our current students, and one another. We are incredibly grateful. Before we part, I have a few quick housekeeping remarks, so I hope you will please join us for a cocktail reception in honor of Sharon Oster. Upstairs on the second floor concourse, we will be serving Ostertinis. And you will you can use the staircases at either end of this hallway right here to reach the second floor. There are also elevators in these three corners of the building, the two nearest being over in the atrium here. So class dinners will follow, so please check your print program or the event app for exact times and locations. And we'll see you upstairs. Thank you.